Okay, good morning, children.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. How was your exam?
Very easy.
Very easy. All of you. Yeah, okay. Then what all things we had discussed in the last class? Nivedya, can you tell me what about the topic? Two types of changes, right? Yeah. Tell me. Yes.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Change a pure copper sulfate from an impure sample.
After that, we had discussed one more topic, right?
No.
No? Nothing?
No.
Then about crystallization is better than evaporation.
Okay, okay. Then about the water purification system also, right?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Then today we are going to learn about two types of changes. Two types of changes. So they are known as physical change and chemical change. Physical change and chemical change. Okay. First one is known as physical change. I will tell you two situations. Okay. You can identify what's the difference between these two. I'm going to crush one paper. Okay. I'm going to crush one paper. So you can tell me. Just wait. Okay, this is a piece of paper, right? I'm going to crush it. Is this paper again re-back to its original state?
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
Yes, right? Yeah, we can make back it into its original state, right?
Yes.
Yes. So what change occurs to this paper on crushing?
Physical change.
Yeah, that means size and shape changes, right? So the physical properties or the physical states change. The size and shape change. The next situation, burning of paper. Burning of paper. It will be converted to ashes, right? On burning, it will be converted to ashes. Is it possible to bring back this ashes again to paper?
No.
No, right? A new product is obtained there. Not only the physical properties like size, shape, like that. Here a new product is obtained. That means a chemical change or a chemical reaction take place there. So the second one, that means burning of paper, it's an example for chemical change. So that's the difference between physical change and chemical change. All of you switch on your videos. In the case of physical change, only the change in size, shape, etc. take place. Okay. Then we can regain or we can back it to its original size and shape. But in the case of chemical change, a chemical reaction take place. A new product is obtained. We cannot bring back it to its original state. That's the difference between physical change and chemical change. This is clear, children?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Then we can learn more about this. First one, physical change. The process which brings about changes in physical properties and no new substances are formed. They are known as physical changes. Okay. The process which bring about changes in physical properties. Physical properties. Such physical properties are color, hardness, rigidity, fluidity, density, melting point, boiling point, etc. Okay. What do you mean by rigidity? Rigidity.
Toughness.
Which one?
Toughness.
Yeah, toughness or strength, right? Yeah. So color, hardness, rigidity, then fluidity means ability to flow. Okay. Then density, melting point, boiling point. Melting point means the temperature at which substance starts to melt. Okay. Then boiling point means the temperature at which liquid starts boils. So these are certain physical changes. In the case of physical changes, these type of changes occurs. Change in color, hardness, rigidity, fluidity, density, melting point, boiling point, etc. So the process which brings about changes in physical properties and no new substances are formed. Okay, look at these examples. This one is cutting of wood, right? Cutting of wood. This is one example for physical change. In this example, any new product formed here? Cutting of wood. No, right? The same wood, it will be changes into small sizes, right? Next one is melting of butter. Here also, no new product formed, it is melted, right? Then you can also write boiling of water. Then melting of ice. Then cutting of wood, crushing of paper. These all are examples of physical changes. So you have to note the point, the process which brings about changes in physical properties, only changes in physical properties, and no new substances are formed here. It is known as physical change. And the common physical changes are changes in color, hardness, fluidity, rigidity, density, melting point, boiling point, etc. Okay.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, if we melt the butter and turn it into ghee, it is a physical change.
That is not ghee. Butter, it is on melting, it will be converted to in the liquid form. It's not ghee. Ghee is another one, right? Ghee can exist in two forms, in solid form and on heating it will be melted. Ghee is another substance. Sorry, butter is another substance. It can be also exist in two forms, both in solid form and liquid form. Okay.
But somewhere I have heard that by melting butter we can turn it into ghee by some more process.
It's not proper ghee. You can see that ghee can exist in the solid form on lower temperature, right? And then on heating, this ghee can be converted into liquid form. Similarly, this cheese or this butter, it can also exist in two forms, in solid form and liquid form. On heating, it will be converted to liquid form. But it's all same substances. Here you look at the boiling of water. On boiling, it will be converted to vapor. But it's not a new product. It's another form of this H2O, right? Water. And ice can be, on melting, ice can be changed to water. It's ice, then water. But these two are the same components there. H2O is present. It's in solid state, it's ice. Liquid state, it's water. Then vapor state, it is water vapor. The same content there, right? H2O, that's it. Okay. Yes, so these all are examples of physical changes. Have you completed? All of you, switch on your videos. Fadil, can you please read the slide with examples?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Physical change. Mm-hmm. The process which brings about changes in physical properties or no new substances are formed are physical changes.
Okay.
The common physical changes are changes in color, hardness, rigidity, fluidity, density, melting point, boiling point, etc.
Okay.
Examples are the cutting of wood, boiling of water, melting of ice, melting of butter.
Okay. Shall I move to next page, children?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. The next one is chemical change. Chemical change, the process in which new substances are formed and chemical properties of substances get changed are chemical changes. Some chemical properties are order, inflammability, etc. The process in which new substances are formed. Do you remember the new substance formed in burning of paper, which is the new product formed there?
Ashes.
Yeah, ash. It is converted to ash. That means a new product is formed there. This is not similar to that of paper, right? So the process in which new substances are formed and chemical properties of substances get changed. That means a chemical reaction takes place there. some chemical properties are odor, inflammability, etc. Okay, so these type of changes are known as chemical change. Then we can write the example: burning of paper. Any doubt, children? Any doubt there? Burning of paper. Okay, then cooking of food, vegetables, it will be converted to another substance, right? That means curry. The raw vegetables, it is converted to another one, that means in the form of curries, right? So cooking of food. Then rusting of iron. What do you mean by rusting of iron? Rusting of iron. This is the image for rusting of iron. You can see the chemical change occurs to this iron. When they contacts with air or moisture, these metals react with air and water present in the atmosphere. Okay. And a new product is formed. That means rust is formed. That's in brown color. Rust. Okay. So these three are examples for chemical changes. Burning of paper, then cooking of food, then the third one is rusting of iron. This is clear? Burning of paper, then cooking of food, rusting of iron. These all are examples of chemical changes. The process in which new substances are formed and chemical properties of substances get changed are chemical changes. And these chemical properties are odor, inflammability, etc. Yeah.
What is odor?
Odor means smell. Smell.
Okay.
Inflammability means its ability to burn or to make flames. Clear? So these are two types of changes: physical changes and chemical changes. Yeah.
Can you show the previous slide? I lost my network.
Sure, sure. Have you completed this one? All of you.
Yes, ma'am.
All of you. Yes, right? Yes, okay. Okay, then you can complete it. Amin, Adelio, Anashwara, Ken, Prithvi, Kausan, Abhiram, Anjana, Ellen, Albert, Advait. All of you switch on your videos. Have you completed, Lakshmi?
1 minute.
Okay, okay. Yes, right?
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Then we can discuss certain changes And you have to identify whether it belongs to physical change or chemical change. Okay, that's from the textbook, page number 24. Page number 24. Classify the following as chemical or physical changes. Classify the following as chemical or physical changes. So, first question to Navaneet. Cutting of trees, which
change? Ma'am, physical change.
Yeah, you can write the physical change. Cutting of trees, it belongs to physical change because no new product is formed there, right? That's why. Physical change. Then Isha, melting of butter in a pan. Melting of butter.
Ma'am, physical
change. Yeah, it's also physical change. You can write there physical change. Then Amin, third one. Rusting of Almira.
Chemical.
Yeah, it's chemical change because a new product is formed. That means rust is formed on Almira, right? That's why it belongs to chemical change. Then next one, Adigesh. Boiling of water to form steam. Boiling of water.
Physical.
Yeah, it's physical change because no new product is formed. Water vapor is formed. It's a form of water itself, right? So it's also physical change. Next one, Suryadev. Passing electric current, passing of electric current through water and water breaking down into hydrogen and oxygen gases.
Chemical change.
Very good. Chemical change because a chemical reaction takes place there. And two new products are formed, that is hydrogen and oxygen. Water molecule is split into hydrogen and oxygen. New product is obtained. That's why it belongs to chemical change. Okay. Then next one, Alvin. Dissolving common salt in water. Which type of change? Dissolving common salt in water. Which one? Yeah, it's physical change because we are simply adding the salt into water. We can again reback it into original state. That means on evaporation, salt will be obtained, right? So it is also physical change. You can look for two criteria. First one, if new product is formed, chemical change. Then if it backed again to its original state, it is physical
change. Page number
24. Switch on your video, Ellen. Are you there at home? Yeah. So dissolving common salt in water, it is physical change. Next one, making a fruit salad with raw fruits. Yeah, making a fruit salad with raw fruits.
It's physical, right?
Yeah, it's physical because no new product is formed. The same vegetables, they are cut into pieces. No heating process there, right? You're just mixing all vegetables, all fruits together. And we just add something to make it more tasty. That's it. No heating process there. No chemical reaction there. That's why. Then the last one, Alan, burning of paper and wood. Is it physical change or chemical change? Burning of paper and wood. Which one? Chemical change. Yes, it's chemical change because on burning, it will be converted to ashes, right? So now you are able to classify the changes into physical or chemical, right? Yes, isn't it? Yes. So these are the questions based on this physical and chemical changes. And there are certain questions just before this. We will discuss these questions now. Okay, it's based on the previous portion, but we can discuss it. Who will read the first question? Adelio, can you please read first question? How will you separate? Is clear and mute. Wait. Adelio. Can you unmute? Any issues there? Okay, Hira, can you please read?
How will you separate a mixture containing kerosene and petrol different in their boiling points is more than 25 degrees Celsius, which are immiscible with each other?
Yes, how will you separate a mixture containing kerosene and petrol, then difference in their boiling point is more than 25 degrees Celsius, which are miscible with water? So can you tell me which method is used there?
Distillation.
Yeah, distillation. Okay, you can write the distillation. Fractional distillation is used when the difference in boiling point is less than 25. Okay. Nandana, the next question, second one.
Name the technique to separate first one, butter from curd.
Yeah, first one, butter from curd. Name the technique to separate butter from curd. Which method is used?
Centrifugation.
Yeah, centrifugation. That's right. You can write there, centrifugation. Centrifugation. What's the principle there? The lighter particles will be at the top and the denser particles will be at the bottom. So we can able to separate butter from curd. Then next one is salt from seawater. Which method is used? Salt from seawater. Salt from seawater. Anyone can reply? Yeah.
Evaporation.
Not evaporation. We learned one more method last.
Now crystallization.
Yeah, crystallization. You can write there, crystallization. Then Advait, Murali, last one, camphor from salt. Which method is used? Camphor from salt. Camphor from salt. Yes, unmute.
Can I?
Ma'am, can I?
Yeah, Advait, what? Yeah, sublimation, sublimation.
Sublimation.
Yeah. Then Jairus, can you read the next question? Third one.
What type of mixtures are separated by the technique of crystallization?
Yeah, what type of mixtures are separated by the method of crystallization? You can tell me which type of solids, which type of mixtures? They are in which state?
Solution.
Not solution.
Solid state.
Solid state. Yeah, solid state. You can write the solids. Okay, crystallization method is used to purify solids. Yeah, Ritvik, that's right. Solids. Is this clear, children?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Then the next part, that is the classification of pure substances. In the beginning, you remember that point? We just classified matter into two, pure substances and mixtures, right? Then we learned about different types of mixtures, homogeneous, heterogeneous, then homogeneous solutions, heterogeneous suspension and colloids, right? Then we are going to learn the classification of pure substances. We learned certain examples for pure substances, right? Gold, pure salt, then pure sugar, like that. Then we are going to learn the different types of pure substances. Different types of pure substances. Okay. So this pure substances can be classified into first elements. Okay. Pure substances can be classified into elements. Then the second one is compounds. Yeah, that's it. Elements and compounds. These are the two classification of pure substances. Elements and compounds. Elements and compounds. your substances are classified into elements and compounds. Robert Boyle, okay, that's the name of the scientist. He is the first scientist who used the term element. Robert Boyle is the first scientist used the term element. Then Antoine Laurent Lavoisier, that's the name of another scientist. It's a very grand name, right? Antoine Laurent Lavoisier. Antoine Laurent Lavoisier. That's the name of the scientist. He established an experimentally useful definition of an element. He just introduced one definition of an element. What's the name of the scientist?
Laurent
Lavoisier.
Starting from Antoine. Yeah, Antoine Laurent Lavoisier. Okay. So Robert Boyle, he used the term element for the first time. Then Antoine Laurent Lavoisier, he established an experimentally useful definition of an element. He just derived a definition for an element. Element as a basic form of matter that cannot be broken down into simpler substances by chemical reaction. So this is the definition. Element as a basic form of matter. We cannot be broken down into simpler substances because it's in the most simpler form. Okay. Element as a basic form of matter that cannot be broken down into simpler substances by chemical reactions. Element as a basic form of matter that cannot be broken down into simpler substances by chemical reactions. And these elements can be normally divided into metals, non-metals, and yeah.
I'm sorry, ma'am. My brother.
It's okay. Okay, so these elements can be normally divided into metals, non-metals, and metalloids. Okay, metals, non-metals, and metalloids. So we classify pure substances into two types, elements and compounds. These elements again classified into metals, non-metals, metalloids. Okay. Anandita, can you please read the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Elements. Robert Boyle, first scientist, used the term element in 1661.
Yeah.
Antoine Laurent Lavoisier established an experimentally useful definition of an element.
Yes.
Element as a basic form of matter that cannot be broken into simpler substances by chemical reactions. Elements can be normally divided into metals, non-metals, and metalloids.
Yes. Have you completed, children?
No.
Okay, then you can complete it. Then we can discuss more about metals, non-metals, and metalloids in the next class. Okay. Finished?
Ma'am, what is gallium?
Which one?
Gallium.
Gallium. It's an example for metalloid. We can discuss it in the next class. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, let me take your attendance. Just wait. Elements and compounds. Okay, these are the two types of pure substances. Then what about the classification of elements? Lakshmi CV?
Metals, non-metals, and metalloids.
Metals, non-metals, and metalloids. Then who introduced this term element? Tom Jones?
I'm Robert Boy.
Yeah. Then who gave the definition of this element, Vaishnavi? Yes, Andoin Lauren Lavo is here. Then we can discuss the remaining things in the next class. Okay. Just 1 minute. Okay, then thank you all. See you in the next class. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.